Okay, in this series of videos, we're going to talk about the ideas behind the time value of money. It's basically some tools that we can look at that will help us to compare dollars received, dollars paid in different points in time. So today as compared to a year or 5 years from now. So we need some tools here to help us make sense and evaluate cash flows that are happening at different points in time. So let's talk about some time value foundations and the fundamental idea behind the time value of money. All the stuff that we're going to talk about in this series of videos is this kind of idea here, that $100 today and receiving $100 today is not the same as receiving $100 a year from now. They are not equal. They're not equivalent. They don't have the same value to us as a person or as a business. And one of the reasons, a really simple way to think about that, a really simple reason for that, me saying that they're not the same, is the fact that there is inflation in our world, typically. Inflation meaning that the purchasing power of money deteriorates over time. You can buy less stuff over time with the same dollars that you have. So, for instance, if a loaf of bread cost $2 today, and I had $100, I could buy 50 loaves of bread. If we looked at that same $100 two or three years from now, and loaves of bread cost me $2.50 because of inflation, I could buy less of them. I could only buy 40 loaves of bread, so I'm worse off, right? So the $100 today gets me more stuff than the $100 that I have at some point in the future. So inflation is a big reason and a very clear reason, kind of an intuitive reason for that. The fact that we can earn money, we can earn interest with the $100 today. If we receive $100 today, we can put it to work and have more than $100 in the future. So we can invest that in a variety of different instruments. We can invest in the stock market. We can buy bonds. We can put it in a money market account, a CD. So we would have more than $100 at some point in the future. So first thing we're going to do, and this is kind of the foundation or the simplest idea in looking at time value considerations, is to think about what money will turn into in the future. Most of you have heard about, thought about compound interest and earning money from an investment, stick some money into savings and let it grow over time. So you've been doing time value stuff, kind of the easiest bit of it, and that's finding out what future value is. So let's assume that we're going to start off with $100. That's called, by the way, the present value. And there's going to be a fair amount of terminology in these series of videos. And I'll try to highlight the important terms, some of the synonyms that go along with some of these terms, so you can start to speak a little bit like a finance person, a person trained in the ways of finance. So we got $100. We're starting with that. That's the present value today. And our question is, what can that turn into in the future? So let's make an assumption here that we're going to let that money grow for 1 year, and it's going to grow at a 10% rate. Okay, so that's the interest rate. 1 year is the amount of time. And so obviously that's a very simple calculation here. Our $100 earning 10% is going to earn us $10. When we add that to our initial investment, the money that we started with, we will end up with, after 1 year, $110 in total. So that's the future value of our $100 after a year, assuming that we earn 10%. Another way we can express that from a mathematical kind of algebraic standpoint is to say that our initial investment, our present value of $100, if we multiply that times 1 plus 0.1, then we get the $110 ending value. So let's just look real quickly at this, a little bit closer at this expression here. $100 times 1, that 1 in the brackets represents our initial investment, our principal, if you will. We're going to get back at the end of it all how much money we put in, hopefully. as we get into some riskier investments, that's not always the case, but the expectation is that we'll at least get back our initial investment. And then the 0.1 is clearly the 10% that we're earning. So we're getting back our initial investment and the earnings on the investment. So that's why we have the 1 plus 0.1. And to simplify that another step, we would just say $100 times 1.1. So that includes the return of our initial investment, the return on our investment, the 10%, and we end up with $110. So let's build on that idea, and we're going to compound the $100, now $110. We're going to compound that one more year. So we're starting off with $110. We're going to multiply that times 1.1. So we're going to get our 110 back plus earn 10% on it. And at the end of a second year, we're going to have $121. Again, assuming that we earn 10% per year. We can break that up and represent that in this equation right here, where we have $100. That's what we started with at the very beginning. We earned 10% the first year. We earned 10% a second year. We also got our money back each of those years, so that's why we have the 1.1. And if you do that math right there, the ending result is the future value after 2 years of earning 10%, and we have $121. Now there's, again, another little mathematical simplification I can do here, and that's to represent that as $100 times 1.1 squared. And that ending result, the future value of the $100 after 2 years, earning 10%, is $121. All right, let's do it one more time. Let's add a third year here. So we're starting off with $121 after 2 years are done. We're going to get our money back and earn 10% interest, so that's why we're multiplying it times 1.1. And we're going to end up with, after the third year, $133.10. That's equivalent to starting with $100, letting it grow three different years, right? We're compounding it 3 years. And at the end of that time, the future value of the $100 after 3 years, earning 10%, will be $133.10. One more time with the simplification, we got $100 times 1.1 now to the third power, and that equals our future value. So let's take a look at a general formula for getting future value. In each of those cases, if you'll look, we have an exponent, and that exponent happens to correspond exactly to how many periods, how many years in this case, that we are compounding our money, or the interest is compounding. And so we, after the first year, we had $100 times 1.1 raised to the first power. After 1 year, we had $110. After the second year, we had $121 that was given by this formula, $100 times 1.1 to the second. And after the third year, we had $100 times 1.1 to the third power. So those kind of specifics lead us to the general observation that we can figure out the future value by taking our initial investment, that's the PV, multiplying it times 1 plus the interest rate, so that's denoted by R, and then raise the amount in the parentheses, raise that to the nth power, where n is the number of periods. In this case, we're talking about years, so 1 plus the interest rate raised to the number of years would give us the future value. All of that stuff that we just did there is called compounding. I'm sure you've heard that term before. Compounding is whenever we're moving to the right on a timeline, when we're going into the future, and we're finding out what some number is going to be in the future based on earning interest over a period of time. The last part of this first video, we're going to take a look at how to do the calculations for future value. And in particular, we're going to focus on the bottom part of the slide using Excel. But with a calculator, what we would do is first find out what the exponent amount would be. So for instance, we would take 1.1, raise it to the third power, and then we would multiply that times the initial investment. So we do it a little bit different, a little bit backwards compared to the formula there. Here it shows PV times 1 plus R to the N. So you wouldn't necessarily put that into your calculator in that order, because it starts to get a little bit tricky. First you would do this 1 plus R to the N, and then go backwards and multiply it times the PV. Obviously exactly the same mathematically, but it's easier in a calculator to do that from a computational standpoint. Much easier still is to use Excel. And again, I've mentioned before that we're going to be using Excel in this class extensively. It's critical that you learn how to use Excel, so we're going to start focusing in on how to do all these things in Excel. That is the preferred method. So we have two different choices when we're doing future value in Excel. One would be to just use the formula, the mathematical formula for future value. So that's, again, equal to future value is equal to the present value times 1 plus r to the nth power. And we could enter that into a cell in Excel and just type in something like this, equals 100 times 1.1 raised to the third power. That little caret symbol there is the indicates to Excel that you're raising something to an exponent, you're raising something to a power. In this case, we're raising 1.1 to the third power. And if you put that in Excel, you'd get the right answer. The other thing we can do in Excel is to use the function. There's a function in Excel called future value, very handy for us. And it's the formula or the function in Excel is you'd type in equals FV, stands for future value. And then you have several different things you would enter, several different arguments for the function that are in the parentheses. And those, specifically those arguments are first the interest rate, and I should say the periodic interest rate. Then you would put a comma, and next would be the number of periods that you're talking about. Another comma, you'd have a regular payment, and then a comma, and the final argument would be the present value that you're investing in. You're going to find out what it's going to be worth in the future. So to go back to our example that we've been working on for a few slides now, if we're finding the future value of $100 after 3 years at 10%, we would type in equals FV, and then in parentheses we'd put 0.1, that's the interest rate, the periodic interest rate. In this case, we're talking about years, so that would be the yearly interest rate. We've got 3 years, so that's the number of periods. We have no regular payments. No payments are occurring in the interim. We just got a one-time investment of $100, and we're trying to find out what it'll be worth in the future. And then the last thing is the present value, and I've put that in as negative 100. We'll probably talk more later about the whys of having a negative versus a positive there, but for now, let's just take it on faith that negative would be a good place or a good way to put that into the Excel function. So first or last thing for this video, I want to go to Excel and just show you those two things. I've got two questions here, two problems where we're finding the future value, and I'd like you to maybe even pause the video here and try to take a crack at those two without looking at the answers that I have here in the middle. The first question is find the value after 11 years of $10,000 invested today, and we're going to use 8% annual compounding. So that's the first one I want you to take a crack at. And the second one, if we've got $100,000 invested today, we're going to see what it's going to turn into 30 years from now with an annual interest rate of 8.75%. So as I mentioned, there's two different ways to go about doing the calculation in Excel. The first one is to just use the formula where future value is equal to the present value times 1 plus the interest rate raised to the nth power. So if I go in here and I put in the present value, that's 1,000. I multiply that times 1 plus the interest rate, so I'm multiplying it times 1 plus the interest rate, 1.08, and then I raise that to the nth power. The nth power is 11, right? That's given to me in the problem. So I stick all that stuff in Excel, type it in exactly this way, equals 10,000 times 1.08 caret 11. That's telling Excel to do a calculation just like our formula says. And the result is shown here, $23,316.39 if we round it to the nearest penny. Alternatively, we could use the Excel function FV, future value, and we would type in equals FV, and I would first enter into the interest rate, and you can see that Excel kind of helps you. It shows you that first thing that you need to enter is going to be the rate. And then if we move over, we're into the number of periods. That's what NPER stands for. Since we've got 11 years, we're going to put 11 here. The next thing that we enter is the regularly occurring payment. In this case, there is no other payments. We're just investing $10,000 a day and we're letting it grow. So there's no additional monies that we're sticking in. And then the present value we're putting in as negative $10,000. I might as well go ahead and mention now the sign convention that I suggest that you use for all your calculations. A negative sign, as we're using in this case, would be anytime you're investing money, anytime you're writing a check. So negative would be to you, from your perspective, which way is the cash moving? So if you invest money, if you invest $10,000, that means you're giving $10,000 to somebody else. You're sticking it into your Fidelity account, into the bank. So it's leaving your possession, going to the bank's possession, for instance. So that's why we have a negative cash flow there. Positive cash flows would be money that you're receiving. So you'll notice here that our answer is a positive number. It's positive $23,316.39. By the way, just like up here. And that's a positive cash flow. That means if I invest my money, if I write a check to somebody or somewhere for $10,000 a day, and I earn 8% for 11 years, at the end of those 11 years, I'm going to get money back. It'll be a positive cash flow to me from my perspective, and the amount of that cash flow will be $23,316.39. Okay, let's quickly go to this second set of calculations where we're finding the future value of $100,000 after 30 years with an interest rate of 8.75%. With the plain old formula, the old-fashioned formula, we take the present value, multiply it times 1 plus the interest rate raised to the number of periods. So I would type in this stuff up here. The present value of $100,000, I'm going to type that in, equals $100,000. Multiply that times 1 plus the interest rate. So I multiply it times 1.0875. Raised to the nth power. In this case, we're talking about 30 years, so I type in caret 30. And the caret is just the shift 6. It's the thing above a 6 on your keyboard. So we're going to raise that to the 30th power, and we get the result of $1,238,448. Alternatively, and this is what I would suggest you do, is use the future value function, where we're going to type in the interest rate. That's 0.0875. The next argument, the next thing we're going to enter is the number of periods. In this case, it's 30. There's no regularly occurring payments in that 30 years. And our initial investments, the present value, is negative $100,000. So we type that in as a negative, again, because we're investing that money. We're writing a check to the investment company. So that's future value with Excel. We'll pick up in the next video with present value.